Most warm welcome to the future of education. My name is Marko Koskinen and I come from Finland. And I'm really sorry that I can't be physically present there at the moment. First, I want to do a small presentation, a video presentation of different kinds of technologies that are coming in near or in a bit further future. And I'm not doing this because I would like to have the technology so much in the education, but because the technology is changing our societies in such a rapid way that we simply cannot ignore it in the education. After this technological tour, I will tell more about what science has to say about learning and how does teaching and learning go together. And in the end, I will give some ideas what the future of education could actually be.
Put this in your ear.
Je mets ça dans mon oreille?
Yeah, put it in your ear.
Comme ça?
Yeah.
Okay.
Can you hear me in French?
Pouvez-vous me entendre en français?
Oui! Mais je peux t'entendre parler français?
Yes, I can hear you talk French.
Comment ça se fait?
But this is awesome. But how you do it?
Yeah, it's translating. It's translating. This little wearable uses translation technology to allow two people to speak different languages, but still clearly understand each other. Simply put, when one person speaks, the other hears it in their language.
112 operator, what is your emergency?
It's my dad. I think he had a heart attack. Please help, he's not breathing anymore.
Please stay calm. What's your name?
Joanna.
Good, Joanna, we've got your location. The ambulance drone is on its way. Remove his top shirt to uncover his torso.
Okay.
Great, can you go to the nearest exit? The ambulance drone is almost there.
Okay. I'm outside.
I'll be talking through the drone now, so you can put down the phone.
Now please pick up the drone and bring it to your father.
You're doing great.
Okay, pull the green lid. Now place the pads on your father's chest. Good, I can see that the pads are properly applied. Joanna, please stay clear of your father. We'll take it from here.
It could be terrible, and it could be great. It's not clear.
Right.
But one thing is for sure, we will not control it.
Go is arguably the most complex board game in existence. Its goal is simple. Surround more territory than your opponent. This game has been played by humans for the past 2,500 years and is thought to be the oldest board game still being played today. However, it's not only humans that are playing this game now. In 2016, Google DeepMind's AlphaGo beat 18-time world champion Lee Sedol in 4 out of 5 games. Now, normally a computer beating a human at a game like chess or checkers wouldn't be that impressive, but Go is different. Go cannot be solved by brute force, Go cannot be predicted. There are over 10 to the 170 moves possible in Go. To put that into perspective, there are only 10 to the 80 atoms in the observable universe. AlphaGo was trained using data from real human Go games. It ran through millions of games and learned the techniques used and even made up new ones that no one had ever seen. And this is very impressive alone. However, what many people don't know is that only a year after AlphaGo's victory over Lee Sedol, a brand new AI called AlphaGo Zero beat the original AlphaGo. Not in 4 out of 5 games, not in 5 out of 5 games, not in 10 out of 10 games, but beat AlphaGo 100 to 0, 100 games in a row. The most impressive part? It learned how to play with zero human interaction. This technique is more powerful than any previous version. Why? It isn't restricted to human knowledge. No data was given, no historical figures were given. With just the bare bones rules, AlphaGo Zero surpassed the previous AlphaGo in only 40 days of learning. In only 40 days, it surpassed over 2,500 years of strategy and knowledge. It only played against itself and is now regarded as the best Go player in the world, even though it isn't human. But wait, if this AI learned how to play without any human interaction, made up strategies of its own, and then beat us with those strategies, then that means there is more non-human knowledge about Go than there is human. And if we continue to develop artificial intelligence, then that means there's going to be more and more non-human intelligence. Eventually, there's going to be a point where we represent the minority of intelligence, maybe even a very minuscule amount.
Hello, I'm Simon Whistler, you're watching Top 10's Net, and in the video today we're looking at the top 10 ways that humans could colonize space. Number 10. Spacecrafts.
The first way we could colonize space is the same way humans have been colonizing the Earth for thousands of years, and that is simply to pack up and move there.
Number 9. Cyborgs.
The idea of upgrading our weak, Earth-loving body parts with robotic upgrades was first proposed in the 1960s by a NASA scientist named Manfred Kleins, who literally coined the term cyborgs.
Number 8. Artificial intelligence.
Humans have yet to send a person to Mars, so you may be thinking, how are we going to colonize even the next solar system, which is 4.24 light years away, if we haven't even set foot on our closest neighbor? There are two major ways that AI could help the colonization of space. The first is that artificial intelligence may be smarter than humans, and it will unlock the secrets to interstellar travel, or even something far more out there like how to use wormholes for space travel. The second way is that we could develop intelligent beings that would essentially pave the way for us.
Number 7. Genetically engineered embryos.
The embryos would be modified to better survive on the alien planet. Then it would be just a matter of shipping the embryos to the new planet.
Number 6. Genetically modified humans.
The solution would be simply to genetically engineer Earthlings that don't age, or age very slowly.
Number 5. Evolution.
An interesting theory about space colonization is that humans may just evolve and become more physically suited at traversing the universe.
Number 4. Self-replicating probes.
While it would start off slow, eventually millions of robots would be constructing millions of robots. Then in 500,000 years, there would be probes reaching all four corners of the Milky Way.
Number 3. Dyson spheres.
A study from Oxford University's Future of Humanity Institute believes that using something like von Neumann's self-replicating robots, we could build Dyson spheres and harness the energy of stars throughout the universe, giving us the energy needed to colonize the universe.
Number 2. Microorganism terraforming.
When it comes to terraforming Mars, we would need to select microorganisms that consume natural resources that are found on Mars. This would have a twofold effect on the planet. The first is that it would transform the soil on the planet, meaning vegetation would be possible, which would lead to more oxygen. Secondly, the microorganisms would also pump gas out into the air, and this would increase the thickness of the atmosphere around Mars, which would make the planet warmer and water would become more readily available.
Number 1. Bacteria.
Researchers believe that in the next 20 years, we should have the technology to store human DNA in bacteria. Once we do that, we could send the bacteria to a distant planet along with microbes that could terraform the planet.
So, first of all, good morning and welcome to Ending Age-Related Disease, the first conference we at LEAF have hosted here at the storied Cooper Union to support the critical work of overcoming the diseases and disabilities of aging.
Welcome back. So now I want to focus more on the science of learning. So basically, there's one great theory called self-determination theory, developed by Edward Deci and Richard Ryan. And it divides motivation into basically two kinds of motivation. Either we are intrinsically motivated to learn something, or there's an outside extrinsic motivation which tries to motivate us to learn. And there's of course clear evidence, and we can all know basically that if we don't want to learn something, it's really, really difficult to make us learn. And with rewards and punishments, of course, we can be directed to learn something simple and basic. But if the content becomes more diverse, more complex, it's almost impossible to make us learn something. I've been teaching mathematics, for example, in the high school, and it's quite amazing that after about 1,000 hours of teaching mathematics to students, Finnish students, which are supposed to be one of the best in the world, I still face many students who have absolutely no idea what mathematics is about or how to do basic calculus. So I think this just shows that in order to for us to learn, it's so important that we actually want to learn it. Another key for learning are emotions. If we feel fear or anxiety or boredom, the learning quality is very bad. So in order to learn, we need to be excited about what we are learning. We need to feel safe. We need to have the environment where we can actually connect with someone. The social aspect of learning is also crucial. So basically, almost all learning is somehow social. Even if we are connected with a computer, a book, or some other kind of means of learning, it's almost always something that has been created by someone else so that we can interact with this either material or some tools, and in the best case, of course, with someone in person. So if we are intrinsically motivated and our emotions are good about learning, there are a couple of things which are still important. One is that we need to be able to make mistakes. If we are not allowed to experiment and try new things and feel safe enough to make mistakes, then learning is hindered a lot. And another crucial aspect is that the thing that we learn needs to be used. So it's not okay that we just learn something and then go on doing something totally different for, let's say, years, because that causes us to forget things. So we need to actively repeat, not necessarily for learning itself, but to keep things in our mind. One example is learning languages. So unless we constantly keep on using the language, we tend to forget it. So to summarize, we need to be interested in what we are learning. We need to have this kind of intrinsic motivation. And the environment where we are learning has to be safe enough, inspiring enough for us to want to learn something new. And we need to be able to make mistakes. This environment has to be safe enough for us to be able to make mistakes. And it's very, very important that the learning is social. Not competitive, but cooperative. So we need to be able to share what we have been learning. We need to get input and feedback from others and share together in small groups, bigger groups, all the things that we are learning. And for all this, we don't need any extrinsic motivation, meaning that we don't need to be punished or rewarded for what we are learning. Because if we really want to learn something, it's actually hard to keep us from learning that thing. So rather than focusing on these kind of directing things, punishments and rewards, we should just keep more space and allow the students to find their own motivation and use that as a driving force. So I want to also talk a little bit about teaching versus learning. We live in a society where the teaching is the kind of a norm for learning. If people say that I learned this myself, it's usually not so valued as if it was learned in some kind of institution. And that's really funny, because if you learn something yourself, you usually have this kind of inner motivation, and the quality of learning is usually much higher than if you learn these things with the extrinsic motivation, which is usually the case inside the institutions. I have spent a lot of my time in the schools as a teacher. And basically what I've learned is that every time I teach something, most of the students are either not interested in the thing, they already know it, or they know too little about it to actually understand what I'm talking about. So maybe 10 or maybe 20% of the students actually get what I'm teaching. So it's a very inefficient way of communicating things. So I've tried to solve these things, and I've looked for options that are available. And there are a couple of things that are really interesting, which allow the student to take charge of their own education. One thing is called self-directed education or self-directed learning, which is basically the idea that we don't say or we don't tell the student what they need to learn or how they need to learn, but instead we follow what the student is interested in and then support and give resources in order for the student to learn those things. Basically, the idea of self-directed education is that the student, him or herself, is driving their own learning. Another interesting method is called flipped classroom, where instead of the teacher teaching during the class, the students are given home assignments where they have to actually study the things before coming to the classroom. And during the class, what they do is not listen to the teacher teaching, but rather they are working with the material they already learned before. So in this way, they are kind of doing this learning twice. They first get the ideas by reading them or getting the material beforehand, and then together in a social environment share what they have been learning. So this has become a very, very efficient way of learning. One very famous method is the Montessori method, which is very much focused on materials. So there are lots of different kinds of games or materials which can be used and given to the children to learn different things. And this is mostly used for younger children, like daycare children and early school years, because many times the materials are quite limited, but they seem to be very efficient in what they are doing. And the method basically is that the students are given a choice which one of the materials they are interested in using and what kind of things they are interested in learning. And after that, the student picks the material they are interested in and use the material as long as they are interested in it, and then return the material. So in this way, it is kind of a limited version of the self-directed education. The students are given the choice what they want to do and what they are interested in. And in this way, it's kind of focused on the intrinsic motivation, but in a very limited way and focused on certain things to learn. Another interesting pedagogical method or alternative is called Freinet, and it's based on a French teacher who constructed a model which is based on workshops. So there will be different kind of corners which have different kinds of materials, also a bit like Montessori, but more focus on actual working. So the students will be constructing something, building something, so it's more actually producing something rather than just playing with some materials. One important way of learning is free play. We many times forget how eagerly children like to play, and it's not because they are just wasting their time. It's actually that they are learning something from the play. And there's a lot of studies which show that as soon as the learning ends in the play, the motivation to keep on playing ends also. So the main motivation for free play is actually learning. And this is something that we usually don't use or utilize in our education systems. So this is why I want to emphasize it also. Next, I want to focus on learning inside school and outside school. Again, there's a lot of research showing that most of the learning happens actually outside the school. And also that the learning outside school becomes many times more meaningful than the learning inside school. I think this is very important because many of the students spend pretty much as time in the school as outside of the school. So if the learning outside school is more important and it's more efficient, then what's happening inside school if the quality of learning is so bad? Well, basically, I guess we've already gone through many of the reasons, like the intrinsic motivation or the lack of it inside school, and lack of possibilities to experiment, lack of possibilities to make mistakes, and so on. And these are possibilities which usually exist outside school, and that's why the learning also is many times more meaningful and more efficient. I guess this is one reason why many people have taking their children out of the school and doing so-called homeschooling. And there's, again, a lot of research which shows that the homeschooling children are doing actually much better than the students inside school, even with the academic studies. And this, again, I think raises a lot of questions on what is the meaning of the school institution. And should it be even continued, or should we just quit all schooling and teach children at home? So I want to make a point for the schools, even though I'm a very huge critic towards schools and education systems. Because I think the schools have a huge potential in bringing young people together for sharing and for experimenting. And there can be lots of different things provided to the young people for learning. And this is something that is very difficult to replicate at home. So the next and the final phase is that I want to show what the future of schools could be ideally. So how can the schools be places where the students can actually enjoy learning and where the learning can be both meaningful and efficient? So I want to give you four examples which I hope will inspire you and keep you evolving and developing the education system. First, I want to say something about what is possible in even poorest areas of the world. Together with local partners in Pakistan, we started a small experimental learning center directed to the local street children who had no access to education otherwise. And the idea was to give them basically freedom to choose about their own learning. But what kind of resources would be meaningful? So the idea was to offer them the modern technology, access to internet basically. Because internet is a kind of a highway to knowledge and information. So if you are familiar with the research and studies by Sugata Mitra, you can have some kind of idea what we are doing here. We are offering to children laptop computers so that they can access the internet in small groups. Many of the children in our centers have to work during the daytime because the area is such a poor area and they have to support their families. At the moment we have three centers running. They are running during the evenings. So they are open about 3 hours per day and the children are divided into small groups so they can all access the computers for at least 1 hour per day. And during this time, they can have a glimpse of different kinds of ideas and things that are online. And of course, almost none of the children who came to our centers in the beginning could read or write. They've been looking at different kinds of videos of learning to read, these kind of basic things first in order to access the internet fully. But already many of our students are reading and they are accessing many kinds of websites and resources from online. So this is a way to show that even with very limited resources, we can offer children an access to information for them to basically teach themselves. In our centers, we don't have any teachers. We have just adults who are volunteering to support the students and make sure that everything is safe and taken care of. All the children need is the access to information and support and safe environment. A second example, which is not actually a school at the moment, but an online learning environment. I started building this online learning system about 10 years ago with the idea that I wanted to offer the students as much freedom as possible while they still need to study certain things based on the national curriculum in Finland. So I started building a set of questions and tasks, basically. I went through all of the 9 years of elementary education, all the subjects, I think about 12 subjects in the Finnish curriculum, and transformed them into questions and tasks. So at the moment we have more than 4,000 questions and tasks covering all of the elementary education for 9 years in Finnish curriculum. The students can choose any of the questions to work on at any point. So they have full freedom to decide about their time, their schedule, and where they study and how they study, because it's all only questions. We don't have any content material. We don't tell that you will find the information here or here, but we just ask them to find the information themselves. We do have some tasks where they need to do some kind of portfolio work, where they need to present something and show their knowledge or skills. So this has been going on for about 8 years now, and we have very good results and very good feedback from the children and the families. And it has so far been going on mostly at homes, but we've tried it also at schools. And at schools, it could revolutionize the way the school is operating. The children could basically be given freedom to decide what they do during the day. They would have the framework of the system. They could work on certain questions at any point of the day. They could choose their classroom where they want to be. The teachers could offer lessons if they want to, or they could just be available in some space where the students could come and work together on certain subjects or certain ideas. And they could use the teachers as resources. So in this way, the school could become a very open learning environment where the students still go through the same content, but in their own space and in their own time. Teachers could follow the progress of the students and making sure that everyone is progressing and could support the ones who might be falling behind or dropping out. The resources of the teachers could be moved from actually using this kind of very inefficient method of teaching into supporting and guiding and maybe creating learning environments. A third example is a Sudbury model democratic school. The idea of a Sudbury model is that the students have a total freedom on what they learn, how they learn, or how to spend their time in the school. Many times they have a certain number of hours they have to spend in the school, but during that time, none of the teachers, none of the students can force or guide what the student has to study or learn or do. So it's a kind of a free community of learners or people who all have freedom to decide about their own doing. But the focus is, of course, on learning and cooperating and being inspired of new things and so on. And one other thing which is very important in the Sudbury model is the how the school is governed. So the school is basically a democratic community which is run by the school meeting. And every student and every staff member has one voice in the school meeting, where all the basically all the matters involved in the school are discussed and decided upon. Every student and every staff member has an equal power to influence the community. The fourth example is as a project that I'm working at the moment. And I'm quite excited and hopeful that it will very soon, hopefully even next autumn. The idea of the project is to allow children or offer children or young people a space where they can fully involve themselves in solving global challenges. I think one of the biggest problems for children at the moment is that they feel very powerless. They see all these kind of problems that the adults have and the societies have, but they are given no way to influence it. Basically, they are just told that you don't have to take responsibility of these things because you are not an adult yet. Let adults take care of these things. But it doesn't help the young people to feel powerful or be empowered. In order for the young people to be fully involved in their communities and societies and become productive members of the society, they need to be feeling powerful already when they are young. Empowerment doesn't just happen when you become adult. It's a process and a learning experience. And in this project, we are offering a place where the children can actually fully immerse themselves in these kind of problem-solving methods and cases, and where they can provide something for the society and feel powerful themselves. So what is my conclusion for the future of education? I think there are many, many options for education to evolve to. I think the future of education is bright, but there at the moment, our education system is struggling very hard to find a way how to become a system which actually supports the children and supports the learning and makes it efficient and meaningful. But we need to change our mindset from the old industrial mindset, which was focused on these kind of rewards and punishments, and to move towards self-directed, student-centered, and learning which is based on intrinsic motivation, and giving the students freedom and space and safety to learn what they really want to learn. Thank you for joining, and hope you have a very nice day.